Welcome to Biology My Passion. I'm Soumya Harikrishna. We are now learning the chapter, The Fundamental Unit of Life, which is nothing but the cell. In the previous video, we discussed unicellular organisms, multicellular organisms, discovery of cells, all this. Today, we will now move on to the parts of the cell. So if you look at any cell, whether it is plant cell or animal cell, basically cell has got three features or three parts. They are, first is cell membrane or plasma membrane, which is the outermost covering of a cell. Inside that, there is a jelly-like substance that is called a cytoplasm. And third is nucleus, which is the controlling center of the cell, or we can call it as a brain of the cell. So now we will learn one by one in detail. The first one, cell membrane or plasma membrane. So cell membrane or plasma membrane is the outermost covering of a cell. But if it is a plant cell, there is one more covering that is called a cell wall. We will deal with that later. Now for other cells like animal cells, the outermost covering is a cell membrane or otherwise called a plasma membrane. When we talk about the cell membrane, we use the term selectively permeable. Permeable means what? Permit. A cell has to transport various substances in and out of it. So here the cell membrane is very selective. Selective means what? It allows the entry and exit of certain substances in and out, but at the same time it prevents certain other substances. That is why it is called a selectively permeable membrane. So if you see, this is a cell and here is the nucleus. So there is a substance like this waiting to go out. Okay, another substance here, another substance like this. So it may allow this one to go out or like that to come in. It may allow this to go out, but it may not allow this one to go out. So certain substances are allowed to go in or out, but certain substances are not allowed. It is very selective in permitting the substances. That's why it is called a selectively permeable membrane. Now, what all are the substances actually moving in and out of the cell? Gases have to move in and out of the cell. Water has to move. Nutrients, all these hormones, vitamins, everything has to move, right? So here, when we are talking about the first thing, that is the gaseous exchange, there are two main gases exchanged between the cell and inside and outside of the cell. One is oxygen, other one is carbon dioxide. Usually the substances move in and out of the cell by a process called a diffusion. So what is diffusion? Diffusion is the spontaneous movement. Spontaneous means what? By its own. Spontaneous movement of particles from a region of higher concentration to region of lower concentration is called a diffusion. So suppose there are particles here of any molecule. Maybe it is a gaseous molecule or liquid molecule, whatever. It is moving or spreading to the regions where they are low. From here, it is spreading. This process is called a diffusion. Diffusion is faster in gases. Okay. So the spontaneous movement of molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration is called a diffusion. We have a lot of examples for diffusion. For example, if you are using a spray, body spray or perfume. When you are spraying it at a particular place, their molecules are more there. But within no time, you know, it diffuses the whole room and you will get the smell of it, right? Because of the diffusion. Or you know that when food is being boiled, so that time you get the smell or the fragrance of the food that is being prepared. Or if you are using an incense stick or an agarbatti, you will get the smell inside the whole room. So these are all due to diffusion. Or if you are putting a drop of ink in a glass of water, you don't stir it, just leave a drop of ink. Slowly it will spread and become evenly distributed within the water. That is also diffusion. So diffusion definition is important. Spontaneous movement of molecules from a region of its higher concentration to a region of its lower concentration is called a diffusion. So the gaseous exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide movement in and out of the cell happens because of diffusion. So usually after respiration, carbon dioxide is produced as a waste material. So once the respiration is over, suppose this is a cell, cell will have lot of CO2 in it because respiration is over. Whereas outside, carbon dioxide is less. So by diffusion, from higher concentration, carbon dioxide will go out. At the same time, what is there outside more? Oxygen. In the atmosphere, oxygen is very high. Compared to cell, more in the atmosphere. So oxygen will come inside the cell by diffusion. So the movement of oxygen and carbon dioxide in and out of the cell is by diffusion. Carbon dioxide is more inside the cell after respiration. So from higher concentration, it will go out where it is less. And the oxygen is more outside the cell than inside, so it will come inside. Another important requirement of any cell is water. So water also can move in and out of the cell, right? But it is by a special kind of diffusion called a osmosis. Okay, so osmosis is a kind of diffusion, but it happens to water molecules. So how will we change the definition? Movement of water molecules from a region of higher concentration to region of lower concentration. Region of high to low of concentration of what? Water molecule. Where water molecule is high, from there, where water molecule is less, it will go there. But here one more condition is there, through a semi permeable membrane. Okay, so when you write the definition of diffusion, three points are important. One, water molecule, high to low concentration through a semi permeable membrane. So how will you define osmosis? Osmosis is the movement of water molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. So now you must be wondering, what is the semi-permeable membrane? Our cell membrane is semi-permeable membrane, or it is a rather selectively permeable membrane, right? So that is called a osmosis. So water moves in and out of the cell by the process of osmosis. So how is this water concentration becoming different outside and inside the cell? It is based on the amount of solute dissolved in it. So we all are familiar with the concept of solution. In chemistry, you learned about solution. Solution means what? It is a homogeneous mixture having two components. A larger component called the solvent, which is mainly the water, which can dissolve some solutes like a sugar or salt. They are called a solute. And you learned there are different types of solution based on concentration. Like there are dilute solution. If solute is very less, then we call it as a dilute solution. Then concentrated solution. If large amount of solute is added, then it is called a concentrated. And if there is a situation or condition where no more solute can be dissolved, that condition is called a saturated solution, right? So like here also, we are talking like that, the amount of solute, but we are mainly concentrating on the concentration of water here. And we are telling here with respect to concentration of the cell. For example, when water is moving in and out of a cell, mainly it is based on the concentration compared to the concentration of water in the cytoplasm, right? So it's not purely water. It is having some amount of substances dissolved in it, but it is neither too concentrated nor too diluted. So imagine here I am putting some solute, very few solute, okay? Whereas here, large amount of solute. But here, solute is more or less same, similar to that of the cell. Okay, so here we talk about tonicity. Tonicity means concentration, but we are comparing with the cell. So here it is very dilute. We can say that this is a dilute solution. Why dilute solution? Solute is very less, solvent molecules are more. Solvent means water, right? So water molecule is more here. So compared to cell, cell has more solute. Compared to cell, solute is less. That means water is more here. So higher water concentration. When you come to the second one, B, here you can see the solute concentration is same like cell, or the water concentration is also similar to that of cell. The third beaker has again 100 ml of water in which lot of solutes are added. So here high solute concentration, so less water concentration compared to cell. When you compare to cell, this has less water concentration. So if the concentration of water is more than a cell, then we call it as hypotonic solution. And if it is more solute concentration, less water concentration, then we call it as hypertonic, because tonicity or concentration is more hyper than cell, that is hyper. Third is equivalent, that is isotonic solution. So always remember, a hypotonic solution, here don't worry about the solute, our concern is solvent or water. So hypotonic solution has more water or higher water concentration. Isotonic means same water concentration. Hypertonic means less water concentration. So from this part you will be getting questions on how can the animal cell be affected when placed in these different solutions. So now let us see what happens to a cell put in these solutions. That's animal cell. Suppose here the first liquid, which is hypotonic, right? Because it has concentration, solute concentration less, hypo, less than the cell, but water concentration is more. So here water will come in and water will go out. Movement is in both the directions. But here more water will come inside than going out. Why? Because water is more outside than inside. So more water will come inside. So as a result, water enters by osmosis and the cell will swell up. Okay, here after some time you can see the cell is swelling up. So this we can see in our day to day life when we are soaking some pulses or dal, chana dal, all this, you know that after a few hours you can see they are all swelling up. Why? Because they have taken in water by osmosis. Now here what happened? Isotonic. Here also water is moving out, water is coming in, but the amount of water moving in and out is the same. So no net movement of water taking place. Net is same, though they are moving, but net effect is same. So cell remains the same. Whereas in the third case, we know cell has more water than outside, because outside solute is more, water is less. So what happens? Here also water will move in both the directions, but more water will go out than coming in. As a result, water leaves the cell and cell shrinks. So in the first case, water entering the cell by osmosis. Entering the cell by osmosis is called endosmosis. Endo means inside. In biology, you always have to remember endo inside, exo outside. So here, through osmosis water is entering, so that is called an endosmosis. Here through osmosis water is leaving, so that is exosmosis, or the cell water is going out of the cell. So to know this, there is an activity given in your textbook. You can take egg, because egg cell, egg, if you have seen, it has got a shell outside. Inside that eggshell there is a membrane, a white membrane. That membrane is called a cell membrane, or a, it is similar to plasma membrane, right? So selectively permeable. You can do this experiment very well with the with an egg without shell. So how will you remove the shell? We know a raw egg, if you remove the shell, means it will break. So you can put an egg inside vinegar and wait for 2-3 days. Vinegar means acetic acid. But if you don't have that, if it is in the lab condition, hydrochloric acid, dilute HCl also can be used. But at home, if you are doing, we can use vinegar. Okay, keep it immersed in vinegar for 2-3 days. You can see immediately bubbles of carbon dioxide coming out. And after 2-3 days, when you take out, all the shell must have dissolved and only the membrane will be there. So by making a small hole, you can take out the inside content of the cell or the egg, then the cell membrane can be used. But here that same egg can be put in a hypotonic solution, and you can see it's swelling up. But if you transfer that swollen egg into hypertonic solution, you can see the cell is shrinking. Okay, that is an activity to prove the exosmosis and endosmosis occurring to cell. Now let us see significance of osmosis. You know, certain unicellular organisms live in water. For example, Chlamydomonas, amoeba, all of them acquire water by the process of osmosis, because through their cell membrane the water has to come inside. The same way plant cells acquire water by osmosis. Aquatic plants, they also allow water to come inside crossing their cell, so it is osmosis. Then roots of plants absorb water from the soil. You know, a root has got a unicellular outgrowth called a root hair for absorption of water. So from the soil, water has to cross that cell membrane to come inside the root. So absorption of water by plants is also an example of osmosis. Another important point that you have to remember is, what is the composition of plasma membrane, or what is plasma membrane made of? So plasma membrane has mainly two major components. One is lipid, the other one is protein. Lipid means what? Fat. Okay, lipids and proteins are also involved. You know, fat is very soft and viscous. So because of the presence of these lipids and proteins, plasma membrane is very flexible. So this flexibility is useful in certain cases. For example, in the case of amoeba, you know, when amoeba is feeding, suppose there is a food particle near amoeba, okay, so that time what happens, amoeba will extend its pseudopodia, means false leg, because amoeba has the ability to stretch its body to form false foot or pseudopodia. Okay, in the next stage, these two will join completely, so that now the food particle is within a temporary food vacuum. Now, enzymes will be secreted here, and the food will be digested and absorbed, and after that this food vacuum will disappear. Okay, it's a temporary vacuum. So here, amoeba is able to extend its pseudopodia. How? Because of its flexibility. What is allowing that? The composition, that is lipids and protein. So this process of engulfing of food particle by amoeba is known as endocytosis. Endo means inside, cyto means cell. So engulfing the food inside the cell, that process is called a endocytosis, which is possible because of the flexibility of plasma membrane. Hope you enjoy my class. If so, please like, share and subscribe to my channel, Biology My Passion.